Hello, this is the short lecture given to illustrate Sobolev inequalities. In the past, we've been working so hard on all those properties of Sobolev spaces, WPP, like its approximation and extensions. We are not doing this for fun, actually. We expect some applications. In PDE theoretical research, we wonder if a sort of space like for starters, W1P can be embedded into other familiar spaces. In other words, if a function U belongs to W1P, does it automatically belong to other spaces? It is clear by definition that W1P can be embedded into W1 and LP, but we are not satisfied with these trivial results. But inspired by this, which inspire us, that can we convert some of this differentiability into integrability, or by contrast, can we convert some of this integrability into differentiability? Although this differentiability is not classical, it's weak derivatives, we only have weak derivatives, but we also fancy something like this. So the answer is yes, and although in different conditions. So we introduce our main theorem for today. Let omega be a boundary open subset of Rn, and C is a positive integer. Then W1C omega can be embedded into LQ omega, where C is larger than or equal to 1 and smaller than n, and C mu gamma omega, where C is larger than n and smaller or equal than positive infinity. So this Q actually is not arbitrary, it's to be set. And here's the deal. We're going to find this proper Q and we're going to prove this theorem. Firstly, let's find Q. That means if something like this holds, what this Q is going to be. This is not going to be arbitrary, and actually it has a specific form. Let's say this again. What does this mean? W1P omega can be embedded into LQ omega. That means for any U in W1P omega, U belongs to LQ omega, and we estimate that U, the norm of LQ omega, is less than or equal to some C times U, the norm of W1P omega. By definition, this norm of W1P omega has two parts, that is U, the norm of P, plus EU, the norm of P. So the key is to estimate something like this, LQ omega is less than or equal to some C times U D U L C omega. For convenience, we enlarge the area from omega to the whole Rn. And also we enlarge the functional space from W1C omega to single 1 omega. Temporarily, for convenience, we are going to find a proper Q under this circumstance. So let's calculate this. This is Rn. We take a U, yeah. Before this, we take a U in single 1 Rn. We take a U from single 1 Rn and take U lambda defined as U of lambda x. Yeah. We insert this U lambda into this inequality. We have Rn U lambda as the part of Q dx. The part of 1 over Q is less than or equal to some C times, let's say du lambda is lambda times du of lambda x. That is a lambda. Rn du lambda x. The power of C dx. Here's a lambda out and the power of C and then the power of 1 over P. So there's only a single lambda out with the power of 1. And then we take T is lambda x. We have Rn U T, the power of Q D T. And there's a lambda, the power of N out. And here's a 1 over Q. So the index is 1 over lambda, the power of N over Q. It's less than or equal to, similarly, the right side is a lambda. Copy this. Rn du t power of p dx power of 1 over p. There's a lambda power of n out. And there's a 1 over p, so n over p. Now this is a LP norm. This is a LP norm. So we write the inequality as the norm of LP we get, and then time this lambda to the right side. We have U, the norm of LQ Rn, is less than or equal to some C times lambda 1 minus N over P plus N over Q times du LC Rn. So since U belongs to the single 1 Rn, it's also this equation is also proper to this U. So this index on the shoulder of lambda is should be zero. We have 1 minus n over c plus n over q is zero. Or otherwise, we can take u is non-zero because we only have to find 1 u. We take this kind of u is non-zero u and a go for the process. And then if this is not zero, we let lambda goes to zero, all infinity will reach a contradiction since both u and du are non-zero. So we got an equation of q, we solve it, we get q is np over n minus p. So this q is not arbitrary, it has a specific form, np over n minus p. So this q is np over n minus p. Now let's prove this theorem. Before prove it, let's write a famous lemma, which is the key, which is the key step to prove this theorem. Very famous lemma. For any u belongs to semi one Rn, again for convenience, we enlarge the area to hold Rn, and we put some more conditions on the function u in semi one Rn. And c is larger than 1, larger or equal to 1, and smaller than n. So we have, and then u, the norm of L qRn, is less than or equal to some c, times du, the norm of L of C Rn, where Q is this, Nc over N minus P, and C only depends on N and P. Notice that before we prove it, notice that u, the compactness of u is essential, because otherwise we take u is 1, so we will reach a contradiction. This is going to zero. It's going to be zero. So this compactness is essential to this lemma. Now we prove it. Firstly, we assume that C is 1. Hence, Q is N over N minus 1. So we are going to calculate something like this, Rn, U, the power of Q is n over n minus 1, dx, the power of n minus 1 over n. But, and the right side would be something similar to du, the power of p, something like this. To combine this u and du together, it occurs us that we can apply Newton-Leibniz equation. We have ux is from negative infinity to xi, d x1, yi, xn. There's xi minus 1. I plus 1, dyi is Newton-Leibniz. And for here, this holds for any I from 1 to n. And we have n fractions like this. We time them together, we have u to enlarge the internal to whole R and put an absolute on it, E, U, U, X1, YI, XN, DYI. So there are N terms. We bind them together, I from 1 to N. The first one, X1, X2, X3, we bind them together. So we divide this as N over N minus 1, N minus 1. It's natural for us to consider this, to integrate the left side on whole Rn and integrate the right side on the whole Rn. But we notice that there are n fractions, n integrals in the right side, and the index is only 1 over n minus 1. So if we integrate this in the whole Rn, it's hard for us to apply this Holder inequality to have a further estimate. So we won't integrate it in the whole Rn. We have to eliminate some of this fraction. We have to eliminate one of this fraction out to use this Holder inequality naturally. So we integrate it with respect to only x1. We have the left side is u x n over n minus 1 e x 1 is less than or equal to. Notice that among these n fractions, there is one fraction that has nothing to do with x 1. Which one? The first one, when I is 1. The x 1 has been integrated. So we extract it out. That is d u x d y 1. First one has nothing to do with x 1. Times the remaining part has n minus 1 integrals. And this index is 1 over n minus 1. So we can apply the Holder's inequality naturally. We have pi from 2. To n e 1 2 e u x e say x 1 y I e x 1 the parabola n over minus 1. There's also a parabola n over minus 1. So this is the first step. We don't integrate it in the whole Rn. We integrate it with respect to only x1. And the next step, we integrate it with respect to x2. Our final goal is to integrate it in the whole Rn. So one by one, we have 1, 2. Ux, the power of n over n minus 1, dx1, dx2. 2, this is left side. Less than or equal to, notice, again, there's also one fraction that has nothing to do with x2. Which one? The second one, minus 2. Since the x2 has been integrated, so it's extracted out 1, 2, dux. dy2, x2 has been integrated. dx1 power 1 over n minus 1 times the remaining part as again n minus 1 fractions. This is 1 over n minus 1. Then by Hodler's inequality, we have this one, 1 dy1 dx2 times pi I from 3 to n 1 2 3 du dy I dx2 dx1. So again, we can integrate it from x3 respect to x3 to xn. We can integrate it, every step we have one fraction that has nothing to do with the corresponding xi. So finally, we get the left side would be Rn Ux, the power of n over n minus 1, dx. Left side. Right side is going to be, eventually, it's going to be pi, I from 1 to n, 1, 2, so now let's assume that C is larger than 1 and smaller than n. We'll apply the results that we have already proven that P is one case. So it's going to calculate something like Rn U at the power of a cube, this time is nc over n minus p dx, less than or equal to some c times, the right side is going to be something with du. We have to find the proper index, then we apply the results of c is one case. So it's hard. Yeah, it's hard to find the proper index in the first place. So we are clever people. We don't stick on it. We can find. We can use this. Apply. P is one case. To function u the power of gamma. Yeah, we don't know how to choose this gamma at the first place, so we use gamma, where gamma is to be selected. We're going to select a proper gamma to finish our proof. So that is Rn. U, the power of gamma, the power of Q, when C is 1, so it's n over n minus 1, dx, n minus 1 over n, is less than or equal to some C, and we know this is 1, but we take this C, Rn. So this du gamma is gamma u gamma minus 1 du. So this is, there is a gamma and u power of gamma minus 1 du. P is 1, so this is 1 and the power of 1 over 1. So we are going to convert the right side to this form. So we use Holder's inequality again. We got the second part is Rn du. We hope there is a p here. Dx. The power of 1 over p. So the first fraction, is going to be Rn u power of gamma minus 1, the power of p prime. P prime is p over p minus 1 dx, the power of p minus 1 over p. So there's inequality. And we'd like to combine these two fractions together. So we need this index is equivalent to this index. So we got gamma n over n minus 1 is gamma minus 1 times p over p minus 1. Then we can solve this gamma to be, I will copy the result, is p n minus 1 over n minus p. So the gamma which was to be selected is actually this. this gamma into this equality, and so then we can combine this to the left, and we calculate this n minus 1 over n minus t minus 1 over p. We can find O, that is Q. You can check if you don't believe it. And this is 1 over Q. And this index is actually Q. You put this into there to check it. So the left side would be U, the normal error Q on is less or equal to the C gamma. This gamma can be absorbed into this C. So C times du lc on. So here's our conclusion of this lemma. Alright, we can use this lemma to prove our main theorem, the case one. Actually, so proof of theorem one. Let's see how much There are, yeah, UN in senior infinity RN such that UN converge to U bar in WMC RN. Since, okay, for any NL that is positive integer, we have UN minus UL. Let's see. This WMC norm has both D consists of LP norm, ULP norm plus DULP norm. So, by this lemma, we have this lemma. UN minus UL, the norm of LQRN, is less than or equal to some C times DUN minus DUL LPRN. So since this in converging for W1PRN, so this goes to zero as NL goes to positive infinity. This holds due to both UM and UL i.e. senior 1RN. So since LQ space is complete, we get UM converge to U bar in LQ space. And what's more, by this lemma, we also have for any n that is a positive integer, un, the normal LQ is less than or equal to some c times dun LP rn. As this is called 4, this is called 5, this is called 6, this is called 7. Let's see whether it's enough for us to make an estimate. Now we put the left side here and the right side here.
LP norm and DU bar LP norm. So
So it's larger or equal, larger than or equal to, we have the this. So we're going to use this, C times U bar, the norm of L, C, du, du, and L, C, R, N. Because the U bar term has been eliminated. And this is the definition. Definition of norm of W1C. And it is larger than or equal to, we have LP, let's say,
thanks for watching.